Hello guys and welcome to the third part of the texturing in Blender 2.8 video tutorial. I'm the creator of the game called Snappy Mouse Run. In the previous video we finished the UV layout of the teapot, and this video will be an introduction to texture painting, where I will show you the most important things you need to know before we get into more advanced texturing methods. Currently we are in the UV editing workspace that can be seen over here. In order to paint the texture we will need to switch to texture paint workspace by pressing this texture paint workspace button. First thing, the layout. Looks similar to the UV editing workspace on the right 3D viewport, same as before. Only difference is that the texture paint mode is active. The left side looks like the UV editor, but it's actually the image editor where we can paint. It's distinguishable by the tool panel with the painting tools. The panel can be toggled on or off by pressing T, and the same panel is visible also in the viewport. In the top bar are the active tool settings on both sides. With few extra options in the viewport, you can toggle the bar on or off under View, Tool Settings. The same settings can also be seen in the Numbers panel on both sides. Press N here to open it. Also, the very same settings can be seen in Properties under the Active Tool tab. It doesn't matter where you change on setting, because the change gets applied everywhere. So, a lot of places where you can change tool settings, and you can actually choose which panel, bar or menu suits you the most. The available tools are Draw, Soften, Smear, Clone, Fill and Mask. And except for the left toolbar, the tools can also be changed from a menu that pops up when you press Shift Space. Changing a tool in the 3D viewport selects the same tool in the image editor and vice versa. So the tool can be used across both views. Since the Draw tool is most commonly used, I will take it as an example while explaining the tool settings, and I will explain them here in the viewport. There are two kinds of settings, tool specific and tool independent. Tool independent settings are those additional options in the viewport that cannot be set in the image editor. The options are texture slots, symmetry, mask and option. Although the options are mixed with the tool specific options in the viewport, these options are shared across all tools. In this video I will cover the most important texture slots options first, then go into the tool specific options and finish the video with the tool independent symmetry option. Texture slots are tool independent, and here we define the actual texture image we are working on. Currently the mode is set to material, and here we can choose from textures assigned to objects material. Our objects material has only this one test grid texture assigned to its base color, so that's the only one we can choose. A quick reminder, objects material can be seen under Properties, Material tab. Here is the base color and its texture. The second mode is single image, and here we can choose the texture from an arbitrary image and also choose a specific UV map which defines the texture mapping. The available objects UV maps can be seen under Object Properties, Object Data tab, UV map. Our object has only this one UV base mapping, so that's the only one we can choose in our single image slot. But the actual image can be any loaded image. We will talk about texture slots a bit more when we'll do projection painting. The most important thing to remember is that the texture slots are only previews for texture painting. It doesn't matter which slot you choose here and paint on, the only thing that is going to be rendered is what you set up in the object's material. Currently the test grid texture is actually going to be rendered, and not the image that is set as a texture painting preview in the texture slots. But we can still edit the image as if it would be rendered. If you're not sure, you can always switch the shader to material in order to preview the actual material texture. Let's change this back to material, test grid. Now let's take a look at the tool specific settings, or better to say brush specific settings. Every tool has its own brush type. The brush is the core component of every tool, and all other settings are actually bound to the brush. So every option you tweak, like strength, color, texture, stroke, etc., will be saved to the selected brush. If you decide to create a new brush by clicking on the add brush icon, give it a name, test brush, and tweak some of the options get stored to the particular brush. If you change the brush back to the old one, the old brush is loaded with its own option. Back to the test brush, and test brush options are loaded. So this way you can create your own brush presets. Only exception is the radius, it's tool independent and will not be saved to the brush. So this is how you create a new brush. How do you delete it? You may think this X stands for delete, but it actually just clears the brush of the active tool. Select the tool again, the brush is still there. There is no right click delete option either. Maybe you have already noticed this behavior when creating images. Same as with brushes, X only clears the selection, and there is also no right click delete option. Brushes and images are project specific data, and an overview of project data can be seen in the outliner with the Blender file display mode. Here you can find, among others, all images and all brushes, and also delete them from the project. Let's find the test brush, right click, delete. Find the previous created image, right click, delete. Select the draw tool again, the brush is no longer there. and the image is also not there anymore. Okay, create a new brush again, I'll name it My Brush. Now let's work with it and see how the other options are used. Pick a color, blue is good, and paint it onto the model in the 3D viewport. As you paint, you can see in the image editor how the color also gets applied onto the map texture. You can also see a projection of the UV layout of the object to get an idea where parts of the mesh are mapped and where to expect the painted color to appear. And it also works the other way around. When you paint onto the image itself, the texture appears on the 3D object. There is also a secondary color, which is active while holding the control button. Also, you can flip primary and secondary by pressing X or by pressing the toggle. If you want to pick a color from the scene or from an image in the image editor, you can use the eyedropper tool, hold the S key, hover with the mouse over the desired color, and release the S key. You don't need to click with the mouse. The shortcut S is nice since the eyedropper is kinda hidden in the menu. The radius of the brush can be adjusted either in the tool options or by pressing F, so you can adjust it on the go. The radius is also locked to the view in the viewport, so you can cover more area by zooming out or less by zooming in, that's a nice thing. And in the image editor this is not the case and the radius is locked to the image. Maybe you have noticed that the alpha option is missing in the color picker. That's because the strength of the brush is the actual alpha. 0 means fully transparent and 1 means no transparency or solid color. Like the radius can be changed by pressing F, you can also change the strength on the go by pressing Shift F. So now we can paint with a solid color or with a more transparent color. When changing strength using the Shift F keys, except for the actual strength value, you can also see this somehow strange curve on the inside of the circle. That is called a fall-off curve and shows the strength distribution across the radius. So if I set strength to a maximum of 1 with this fall-off, we'll get that the strength is 1 at the center and falls to 0 towards the edge. The fall-off is a brush setting and you can choose from the preset ones or define a custom fall-off yourself, for example like this one. Next is the stroke setting. You can choose different stroke methods here and you can also change the methods on the go by pressing E. The default is dots, which applies a dot on each mouse move step. This means the distance between the dots depends on the mouse movement speed. Similar is space, except that here a constant spacing between the dots is defined, so you can get a more continuous stroke. Line is useful if you want to paint straight lines. Airbrush applies the brush at a fixed rate while pressing the mouse. With other methods, the brush gets applied only by pressing and dragging, that's the main difference. Drag dot just drags the dot to a particular place. And with anchored, you change the radius by dragging. The curve stroke is something we will look in the next video since it's more advanced. Every mode also has a jitter option, which generates random displacements when stroking. And some of the modes, like space for example, have a smooth stroke option. Smooth stroke can also be toggled by pressing Shift S in the viewport, and what it basically does is making the stroke kinda lag behind the actual mouse position, so you get a much straighter line and have more time to think your stroke through. The last setting I want to show you in this video is brush independent, and it's the symmetry option. This option mirrors everything you're painting on this side to the other side of the particular axis. For example, this is the global x-axis, with the x symmetry enabled, if I paint on this side, the same will be painted onto the other side. It works for X, Y, and Z, and also for any combination. So, those were the basic texture painting settings. In the next video, we will go through more advanced settings like paint curves and texture masks. Thank you very much for watching. Give a like and subscribe if you found this video useful and want to see more content like this, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye!